Don't forget, our renewal, our reunion is coming up. You need a ride, rides are provided, but you don't have to. You can bring your own car. Yeah, that'd be fine.
Yes, the shuttle is available. You do not have to use the shuttle. There's been a little confusion, I think. But you can use the shuttle if you don't feel like driving, if you don't want to go out there by yourself or something like that. If you have a group too large for your car, you can use the shuttle. They just need to know how many people need the shuttle and for what time. There's a sign-up sheet back in the back, and there's also a schedule in your bulletin. And they really would like a count of how many of us are going to be able to attend by next Sunday. The count is just so that they know how much food to have available. You do not have to bring any food. You do not have to pay for any food. You just come and enjoy yourself. You can come for part of the day. You can come just in the evening for the service. Whatever fits into your schedule. But they just like to see as many people as possible come out, bring your family, your friends, people who haven't been here for a while. Maybe a family visiting that week. Bring everybody you can, because it sounds like a wonderful time. They've put a lot of thought into this. They have tons of activities going on for all ages. So hopefully we'll see you there, but try to remember to get your count in one way or another. You can call the church office, get a hold of Amy Wolford or Ronnie Sines, and give them your numbers. The little tickets that you had were just basically so they could get a count. You know, if you say, oh God, I lost my ticket, I can't go now. Just come out. I forgot to sign up. Just come out. Just come out, enjoy yourself, and hopefully we'll have a really great, blessed event. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Now, if you got a balloon, it's to celebrate Karen Baker's birthday. So you could find her later on and pop it on her, or rub it on her head and make her hair go straight out. What you have left. Any other birthdays we could celebrate with Karen Baker? Nope. Any others? Happy birthday to you. Boom, boom, boom.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you, many more. Praise the Lord. How are the grandparents? Summer Laurel, praise the Lord. Congratulations. Anything else to celebrate? Daughter's home, praise the Lord. She's doing okay. Shall we stand together? Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, we confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God in Christ Jesus, the manna from heaven, we are fed, we're nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, we are shown God's mercy. We are forgiven. We are loved into abundant life. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Together we pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated for sacred scripture.
The first reading is from 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 42 through 44. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing food from the first fruits to the man of God, 20 loaves of barley and fresh ears of grain in his sack. Elisha said, "Give it to the people and let them eat." But his servant said, "How can I set this before 100 people?" So he repeated, "Give it to the people and let them eat, for thus says the Lord, they shall eat and have some left." He set it before them, they ate and had some left, according to the word of the Lord. Here ends the reading of the first lesson. Psalm 145, verses 10 through 18. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your faithful shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and gracious in all his deeds. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing. The Lord is just in all his ways and kind in all his doings. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. The second reading is from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Our gospel reading is from the sixth chapter of John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" Jesus said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people? Jesus said, make the people sit down. Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves. When he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost. So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, this is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world. When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because of strong wind. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But Jesus said to them, it is I, do not be afraid. Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Now, if you have your balloons, get ready. Those are from Vacation Bible School, which is every Monday. It'll be tomorrow. And Tessa Hill passed those out. And if you can imagine, we were just batting those up in the air, back and forth, and playing with them in an activity. And as you bat them around, and you can do it during the sermon, give yourself something to do, notice your hands are up, like prayer. And you're looking. And if you can bat them back and forth, say, and beat 75, that's my number, let me know, and I'll get a gift for you. Okay? But you have to let me know, and it has to be authenticated. No cheating. So thanks for helping. You're going to start batting those back and forth now? It was just for fun. That's why I was rubbing it on my head and seeing if I could get anybody else's hair to stand up. I did some. Mr. Kosler's getting wild. If you get 75, you get a special gift. That might take a while. Notice, see his hands are up as you're trying to hit them? Toward God. So when Tessa shared these balloons with us, I was thinking, you know, it doesn't take much to make us a little joyful. And that's got to be good for the Lord, doesn't it? That we're joy-filled. Praise the Lord. Yeah. One lady said she was allergic to latex. I didn't rub it on her head. They're getting wild now. I hit Karen. Karen needs to be hit. Karen, you should have dove for that. Dive for it. Praise the Lord.
Like a rock concert.
Like a rock concert. Jesus Christ is the rock. Next 6 weeks, 4 weeks or so, Jesus Christ is the bread of life in the 6th chapter of John. So Miss Linda, Miss Cheryl shared with us a message of trust for Vacation Bible School last week. Trust. I can imagine that if you're having a little fun with one another, even if it's just batting a balloon, maybe with the grandkids, your family, a neighbor.
Get the one filled with water.
That would help build trust. A little bit of trust, a little bit of fun, a little bit of joy to build trust in the congregation. To give you an idea of where we are as a congregation, the last time you went out to eat, how was the service? Did you complain? Did you find fault? Were you going out just to make sure if there was anything wrong or out of place, you'd be able to have a comment and complain about it? Maybe that's not your intention of going out, but a lot of times when we do go out, that's exactly what happens. Instead of hands lifted, looking, anticipating, having a little joy, we're so eager and ready to find fault, to complain, to be bitter, to say that person shouldn't have done this or that person should have done that. That's where we are as a congregation. You all know about the barley loaves and the fish, but do you know there's no word of complaint in this gospel text? Makes me wonder, is that the word that we itch to hear? Is that the word we represent? Is that the word we really want to gather around? A word of complaint? It said Jesus told them to sit down. They obeyed. They listened to Jesus Christ. They were following him. Because he was taking somebody who was broken, somebody who didn't have any more hope, and said, "My child, your faith has made you well. You are healed." He was going around making people whole again. And word got out, and they became hungry to follow Jesus Christ, to be near him, to be with him, to witness what God has to offer. It says nothing about complaining. How were those thousands and thousands of people served? I'm sure the service was a lot worse than any service you received in a restaurant. I'm sure the wait was longer. I'm sure the food wasn't cooked properly, and it probably wasn't still warm. Or if it was warm, it was probably a little too warm. Fish. It says nothing in here about the quality of the food. It says all who ate were satisfied. Isn't that amazing? That is a miracle. That is our invitation to the feast, to our gathering. We hear Jesus Christ say, "You are my child. I love you. Your name, your family name, is given to you. And I empower you as a family." Karen read that Ephesians chapter 3. All families are empowered by the presence of this Christ who alone can satisfy. That everyone will know how deep, how amazing, how awesome is the love of God. That you be rooted, not that you root yourself, but you are rooted by the Creator. Fastened on to this love and this mercy of God for the purpose of growing. A little bit of joy, A little bit of mercy, a little bit of love. Any one can reject this gift of Jesus. But he wants us rooted, to be renewed, to be revived, to have a reunion with Christ. You can say, what I have to offer, what I have to bring, is not going to make a difference. And we feel this way sometimes. My words are not good enough. I don't know what to say in a given situation so as to address the hurt or the problem or the complaint. And so we become overwhelmed like a tsunami. It just covers us. We're kind of beaten down like a storm, and we're afraid because Jesus isn't with us. We've lost sight. Once he was with us. Remember then? What age was this boy who brought the loaves and the fish? Don't you think that would be the age for the rest of his life that he would remember and celebrate? That was the best day of my life. I didn't have much to bring, but what I did have, I brought it. And you know what Jesus did? He made it satisfy thousands and thousands of people. Wouldn't you remember that day for the rest of your life? If you had a choice, what age would you be for all eternity? Is there an age you would pick?
25.
Bet you the 20s would be popular, don't you think? If you'd be an age for all eternity, what would you be? I think that's between you and Dan. That's a private session. I mean, but even your baby, right? Do you want a baby with teeth? Once they get teeth, it's all gone, right? When they start getting teeth, they're no longer babies. But would you deny your baby of any stage of life? We expect our babies to grow. We want them to grow. We cultivate that growth in one another, don't we? So if I'm 90, I still am a baby and a teenager and in my 20s and 50 and so on. But we don't look at it that way. We say, oh, if I were only younger again and able to do what I had once done. We think of the church the same way. How many times do we say, ah, I wish things were the way they were back then? It's almost as if you don't agree that the church is an organic being created by God to grow. And it's in its 160s, or it's older, and it's not 20 anymore. So it is not going to be the same. Do you recognize that fact? Is that okay? Are you still satisfied? What little we have to share today, what humble offering we have to place at the feet of Jesus Christ is enough. Not because we brought it, not because of our age or where we're at, not because of the age of the church or any of the other circumstances. Because Jesus is the Christ. That's why it's enough. His love and mercy are enough to heal and to satisfy You have a hunger. It could be spiritual, it could be mental, it could be emotional, it could be physical. You have a hunger. Maybe for the people in Madagascar experiencing a tremendous drought, devastating drought that we've been asked to respond to. You have a hunger, and you have no idea if it's really going to be satisfied or the Lord's going to answer. So what do? We share what we've been given, and we give it to Jesus Christ. Only you can make this work, Lord. Only you can make this right. It's okay to play and have a little joy and raise your hands and hit a balloon. It's okay to enjoy the benefits of being a child of Christ. We don't have to be confined to our complaints and our sourness and our brokenness. The Lord spoke, He divided the meal, and all were satisfied. And that's what He does for His children. So we thank You, Lord, for satisfying us, helping us to see that our little bit is enough when given in Your holy name for Your feast. Amen. We profess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Rooted in Christ, sustained by the Holy Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. Bless the ministries of our neighboring congregations, our brothers and sisters, all throughout Beaver County, Pennsylvania, United States, around the world. Empower churches throughout the world, encouraging missionaries to accomplish what brings you glory, Lord. Kindle in us a spirit of collaboration that all people may know your loving works. As we're mindful of the people of Madagascar suffering in a time of drought and how we are partners in ministry with them. Move us that all may be satisfied in your holy name. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who lead. Cast out ignorance and arrogance, selfishness and corruption. Instruct those who lead to practice compassion and humility. Inspire them with a vision that brings people together and glorifies you. A commitment to ensure that all who hunger are fed. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those bowed down by heavy burdens, those who hate their jobs, those who are unemployed or underemployed, those unable to find affordable housing, or they live in a place that is not safe and is not right. We pray for those without health insurance, those who are living a very risky life day to day, moment to moment. Pray for those that cannot be consoled in their grief. And we hear the cries of those who call to you for healing. And we lift to you our loved ones, those who are in our hearts, on our minds, for you to embrace, dear Lord, and to satisfy them. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for this assembly. Deepen our resolve to use what we have to serve those in need. When we worry that we do not have enough resources for ministry, assure us of your abundance. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the offering. Let us pray together. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus, he took the bread, gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." The body of Christ given for you. Again, after supper, our Lord Jesus, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me, the blood of Christ shed for you." Lord, remember us in your kingdom, teaching us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen us and keep us in his grace. Amen. Together we pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us and journeys with us, be upon us now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. We are the body of Christ.